Real change requires honest community. Honest community. Now, there are some things that you're never going to be able to change on your own. You're going to need people in your life for support. You're going to need a small group that can be gut-level authentic with you. Some of the things in your life have to be team tackled. You know, it's like in a football game. Sometimes a opposing player is so big, you can't pull him down by yourself. There are some problems in your life you need to team tackle. And that's where you need a small group. But it's not just a normal small group. It's a small group where you're gut level authentic, where you can talk about the areas of your life where you're weak, where you have a defect, where you have a problem, an inborn pattern. Now, that you don't have that kind of intimacy right up front when you first start a small group. But as you get together and you begin to trust each other and you develop a safe environment, now you're going to have people in your life who can help you change areas that you can't change on your own. Here's a verse about this. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25. No more pretense. Tell your neighbor the truth. In Christ's body, we're all connected to each other. So if you lie to each other, you end up lying to yourself. He says, if we're all in the body of Christ, if I lie to you, I'm really lying to myself. You know, friends, we waste an enormous amount of energy just pretending to be people that really not. Listen closely. If you are serious about changing things in your life that have seemed to be unchangeable, if you're serious about growing in Christ, if you're serious about removing some of the defects and some of the weaknesses and some of the things you don't like about yourself, you're going to have to face your fear. And what is that fear? You're going to have to face your fear of being honest with a few other people, because that's the only way you're going to be able to change. You won't do it on your own. If you could, you would, but you can't, so you won't. You need other people. You've tried doing it by yourself, and it didn't work. You see, friends, our biggest hurdle to growth, our biggest hurdle to maturity, our biggest hurdle to holiness, to Christ-likeness, you know what it is? It's our desire to look good. And if my desire to look good takes precedence over actually being good, then it gets in the way. But when you're in a little Bible study group of three or four or five or six friends where you don't have to look good, where it's okay to, you know, just to be yourself, now you're in a place of safety where you can actually grow. You know, the group that I'm in right now, I think we've been together 16, maybe up to 20 years. I don't ever remember, but it's been a long, long time. And, you know, we were talking the other day that I think every one of us in our group have fallen asleep in small group at least one time. Me, many times. But, you know, that's actually a compliment, because it says, I trust the people around me enough that it's a safe enough place. I could fall asleep and drool and they wouldn't care. Now, the small group should be one place where you can be real. And that's what that verse was talking about. Let me give you another one. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. It says there, be kind and loving to each other, forgiving each other, just as God forgave you in Christ. That ought to be happening in a small group. You know, when you make a mistake, then the world basically reemphasizes it and makes it a big deal. But the church says, no, it's not a big deal. We're here with you. We're going to help you through this. We're going to walk you through this. That's what a good small group will do. Verse 29 in Ephesians chapter 4 says this. It's a guideline for small groups. It's a guideline for authentic or honest community. It says, never use harmful words, but speak only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs. In other words, I don't say what I need to say. I say what other people need to hear according to their needs, not my needs. Always, it says, never speak words that are harmful. Speak only helpful words that build others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. You know what? We'd have a lot fewer problems in the world if everybody followed that verse. You know, some of you are not in a small group yet. I want to help you start one this week. I can help you get a couple friends to help you start. You need to be in a group for your own spirituality, your own maturity, your own spiritual health. And for those of you who've never been in a group, let me just quickly go over the four ground rules of Saddleback small groups. Here they are. I actually put them there on your outline. Number one, what is said in the group stays in the group, okay? That's confidentiality. So in my group, I share stuff with my small group. They would never share it with anybody else. And they've told me things that I would never share with anybody else. What is said in the group stays in the group. Second rule of a small group is you don't minimize other people's pain. You don't say, well, okay, I had that pain and it wasn't a big deal, or you know, what? Don't minimize other people's pain. Number three, don't try to fix people. When somebody starts sharing an area of weakness or a defect or a fault or a problem or a sin or a temptation, you just listen. You don't try to fix people. You just listen. That's what, there's the healing power of your ear. And then number four, the fourth ground rule is I focus on my own changes. I don't focus on changing you. That's not the goal of my group. The goal of my group is I focus on changing me and you're focusing on changing you, but we're helping each other all along. You need authentic, honest community if you're gonna make the most difficult changes in your life.